Blackstone Audio presents The Citizen Patient, Reforming Healthcare for the Sake of the Patient, Not the System, by Nortin M. Hadler, M.D. This book is read by Tom Weiner. For Carol S. Hadler, always. Acknowledgments. I am privileged to work in one of America's underground academic clinical departments, of which there are many more across the country. Here, committed clinicians, clinical scholars, and clinical investigators hang out. Most keep their heads down, engaged in their life pursuits with determination and enjoying the self-satisfaction of ever-improving competence. None seek rewards or career options that veer away from these pursuits or that might possibly corrupt their professionalism. These men and women were once the essence of American medicine. Today, they are a threatened species. I am proud and grateful to be one in this fold. This is my peer group, without whose acceptance and encouragement the writing of The Citizen Patient would have been a burden instead of a mission. Perhaps The Citizen Patient will rally others to the mission of these professionals. Until then, they might find comfort in these words by E.E. Cummings. To be nobody but yourself in a world which is doing its best day and night to make you like everybody else means to fight the hardest battle which any human being can fight and never stop fighting. And I am fortunate and privileged to have found an author's home at the University of North Carolina Press. It is truly a home with a family that has supported my efforts through four books, culminating in The Citizen Patient. I owe particular thanks to my editors, David Perry, editor-in-chief of the press, and Jay Matsaki. David has worked tirelessly to aim me toward the goal of clarity, and Jay has added the polish. I thank Gina Mahalik and Dino Batista and their colleagues for working to make sure the products of all these efforts see the light of day. Introduction. There is a difference between the health of the person and the health of the people. My last four books dissect the former from the perspective of the patient. The Last Well Person, 2004, Worried Sick, 2008, Stabbed in the Back, 2009, and Rethinking Aging, 2011, are meant to teach readers how to ask, "Will this really benefit me?" when faced with prescriptions for improving or preserving their health. Those who have read these books are in a position to recognize medicalization and overtreatment in all phases of life and for myriad complaints. Furthermore, they will understand what is entailed in making informed decisions about their own medical care. The Citizen Patient does not further dissect the patient-physician relationship solely to enlighten individual medical decision-making. Rather, it unpacks and examines the modern doctor-patient relationship and the many perversities that characterize the American healthcare system in order to enable readers, as enlightened citizen patients, to put that knowledge in the service of change. A necessary first step in devising a rational solution to our national healthcare problem is preparing all patients to take responsibility for assuring that whatever is being said or offered or done will really be to their benefit. If healthcare and the system that underpins it were intrinsically trustworthy, patients could relax, secure in the knowledge that whatever happens to them has a salutary benefit-to-risk ratio. Sadly, we know that this is not the case. In fact, the present healthcare system is structured to frustrate that security. Any discussion of healthcare must necessarily begin with a discussion of health. What do we mean by health? One can enjoy good health or suffer bad health. Is bad health no more than the absence of good health? Is there a continuum between good and bad health? Can either be objectified reliably? Good health is not the absence of symptoms. All of us will suffer symptoms repeatedly, symptoms that give us pause without compromising our belief that we are basically well. Episodes of backache, headache, heartache, colds, flu, and much more are predicaments of life for which most of us are a match most of the time. Despite such predicaments, we can remain in good health. Nor is health the absence of disease. If we define disease as pathology, as abnormalities in our anatomy or physiology, By midlife, all of us harbor diseases, and I mean important diseases. Some of these are so commonplace as to be part of the course of life. Gray hair, bunions, degenerative changes in the spine, hardening of the arteries, some forms of cancer, and the like. Some are lying in wait to smite our good health. Some are contenders for the ultimate smiting, the cause of our demise. Most will still be lying in wait on that fateful day. Despite our diseases, we can remain in good health. Health is not a purely scientific construct. The components of health that can be quantified and studied systematically barely scratch the surface of what most of us mean by good health. Science is no match for individual perceptions of well-being, for the temporal component of well-being, or for the vagaries of the social construction of well-being. A century ago, obesity indicated good health, while today it's generally considered to indicate bad health, even though we know that it is the correlative socioeconomic status that influences health far more than heftiness itself. A century ago, orgasms were considered bad for you. Today, their absence is considered something that merits treatment. Health in general, and good health in particular, does not lend itself readily to easy understanding because it has many components and reflects so much that is our humanity. In that regard, it is similar to other hard-to-define concepts, such as love and job satisfaction. Many elements contribute to health, only some of which are defined, and all of which display enormous individuality. That being the case, what do we mean by healthcare, the healthcare system, and healthcare reform? These and many similar terms are no longer the language of policy. They have become common parlance. They all presume that good health will result if we prevent bad health. Further, if bad health surmounts our defenses, we can call on trained professionals whose job it is to identify and try to fix the diseases and disorders that render health bad so that good health will reemerge.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.